Hello, today is Friday, November 19th, and we're a little early this month with Friday 5 at 5 with the Denver Public Library because of next week's Thanksgiving holiday. My name is Erin. I'm a librarian at DPL's Central Library, and in 15 minutes or less, we'll have you up to speed on five new titles we can't wait for you to read or listen to just in time for the leftover-filled long weekend. DPL has a very special event coming up in early December that we want you to know about. Since 2015, Bryant Terry has served as Chief in Residence at the Museum of African Diaspora, where he creates public programming that celebrates the intersection of food, farming, health, art, culture, and the African diaspora. He has won both the James Beard and NAACP Image Awards and is renowned for his activism to create a healthy, just, and sustainable food system. On December 7th, we'll be hosting a virtual conversation with Bryant Terry, which will be moderated by YouTubers Cecilia and Josh Hem Lee, creators of the Trenny Regan Vegan videos. Registration info at the link below. Please join us. And now on to the book recommendations. It seems appropriate to start with a cookbook. Abra Behrens, a James Beard semifinalist for Outstanding Chef, Great Lakes, and the author of Roughage, shares more than 300 recipes and variations, plus substantial reference information to help you discover the next great grain in her latest cookbook, Grist, a practical guide to cooking grains, beans, seeds, and legumes from Chronicle. Available at DPL in print and as an ebook through Overdrive. Grist includes more than 125 recipes for 29 different types of grains, legumes, and seeds that, in combination with vegetables and lean proteins, are the stars of the healthiest, most variable, and most satisfying meals, many of them gluten-free. Recipes are first organized into three categories, grains, seeds, legumes, then by preparation method, boiling, pan frying, milling, sprouting. Behrens shares dozens of tips for choosing, storing, and cooking these staples, guiding readers through some things to know, including how to mitigate swings in gas. Woven throughout are essays and farmer interviews that present a strong case for increasing the role of grains and legumes in the global food system. Pair this with The Good Berry Cookbook, Harvesting and Cooking Wild Rice and Other Wild Foods by Tashia Hart, which recounts the history of Manuman wild rice told through cultural practice, traditional ecological knowledge, scientific observation, and inspired dishes that feed the senses and the body. And try Mother Grains, Recipes for the Grain Revolution by Roxana Julepat. On January 12, 2010, Haiti was hit by a devastating earthquake, one that killed between 250,000 and 300,000 people and left more than a million homeless. Haitian-Canadian-American author Miriam J.A. Chancy wanted to write something that showed how lives were destroyed or disrupted by this catastrophe. She accomplishes this in What Storm, What Thunder, a novel of immense power and rare sensitivity that keeps readers and listeners in its firm grip until the last page. Each chapter follows a different character whose life was affected by the earthquake, but the result is much more than a multifaceted telling of a devastating event. It is also a portrait of a community connected by ties both strong and fleeting as it navigates the disaster and the terrible burden of standing up and beginning to rebuild. And it is an indictment of a world that watches current events like they are reality TV, forgetting the human beings still living, dying, and struggling when the cameras go off. This book is as devastating as it is beautiful. From publisher Tin House and available in print from DPL, as well as in ebook and e-audiobook formats through Overdrive. Partner this with Jessamyn Ward's Salvage the Bones, which depicts a family hoping to survive Hurricane Katrina, and get a different take on the 2010 Haitian earthquake in God Loves Haiti, author Dimitri Ilias Lagar's debut novel of romance, politics, and religion that traces the fates of three lovers in Port-au-Prince. English author Sarah Hall began writing Burnt Coat on the first day of lockdown in March 2020, imagining herself as a first responder in her capacity as a writer. Hall's sixth novel, with its quarantines, variants, and domestic death behind closed curtains, could only be more current if it were serialized on social media. A merciless virus has paralyzed the planet. The narrator, a lauded sculptor named Edith Harkness, has been commissioned to create a piece as a national memorial to those who died during this iteration of infection. As she works, Edith, who is infected with the virus, reflects on her childhood, family, friends, and lovers, and how her most significant artwork may be her last. The novel is written in the second person, addressed to Halit, a Turkish immigrant with whom Edith began a relationship before the pandemic. The novel's imagery constantly reinforces the notion of art and artists forged from catastrophic damage. A year ago, the phrase pandemic novel may have evoked an instant visceral discomfort, but Hall did not walk away from this challenge. From publisher Custom House, available at DPL in print as well as in ebook and e-audiobook format through Overdrive. Along with Gary Steingart's Cosmopolitan, Our Country Friends, and Louise Erdrich's The Sentence, which centers on a Minneapolis bookstore in 2020 in the city's multiple crises, from the pandemic to the murder of George Floyd, Sarah Hall is at the edge of this inevitable mini-genre. How much can one author cram into a novel? Tade Thompson's Far From the Light of Heaven is an action-packed murder mystery cum science fiction space voyage. Shell has trained for years to go into space and now finally has her chance as a pseudo-captain of the Ragtime, a 1,000-passenger transport bound for the colony of Bloodroot. It's a bit of a joke, though, that all this training is mostly superfluous, as all the real work is done by the ship's AI while she and the passengers are in an induced sleep. But when she wakes on the other side, it's to disaster. Ragtime isn't responding, and dozens of passengers are dead. Desperate to save the rest, she contacts Bloodroot for help, and they send her Finn and his AI partner, Salvo. Finn's currently in disgrace due to a repatriation job gone wrong, but surely even he can figure out what murdered the passengers. But more importantly, they need to figure out how to survive, because the actions they take on this one spaceship may soon affect the future of the entire galaxy. Available from publisher Orbit, in print at DPL, and as an ebook and e-audiobook format through Overdrive. It may evoke thoughts of the movie Sunshine, with a dab of James S.A. Corey's Leviathan Wakes. Far From the Light of Heaven is nail-biting and intelligent, and if you love the locked room mystery, consider picking up Tess Little's The Last Guest, set in posh L.A., or The Album of Dr. Moreau by Daryl Gregory, which features the Wild Boys, the world's hottest boy band. Osceola County, Florida, begins at the southern gates of Disney World and stretches down Interstate 192, a drag lined with mini malls, evangelical churches, flea markets, pawn shops, and dollar stores. Today, a minimum wage earner can afford a one-bedroom apartment in only 145 out of 3,143 counties in America. One of the very worst places in the United States to look for affordable housing is Osceola County. In his new book, Sunbelt Blues, The Failure of American Housing, Andrew Ross describes the county's two distinct housing markets. There is the 15-bedroom home in Reunion that rents for $50,000 a week for VIP Disney visitors, and there are the $40 motel rooms for those turfed out of their apartments. It is no accident that the divide is deepening in a place with rising property values and a major employer that pays poverty wages for intense physical and emotional labor. Like a medieval castle, Disney World relies on an illusion, where the comfort of the feted guests is sustained by staff who can barely get by, forced to pack into stables and even camps out near the edge of the ramparts. Ross, a professor of social and cultural analysis at New York University and a social activist, examines the market forces and lax regulations that promulgate human suffering, and shows that treating housing as an investment rather than a basic human right has horrific, real-life consequences. From publisher Metropolitan, available at DPL in print and from Overdrive in ebook and e-audiobook formats. To continue the dive into the housing crisis, consider Underwater: How Our American Dream of Home Ownership Became a Nightmare by Ryan Dezember, or Invisible Child: Poverty, Survival, and Hope in an American City by Andrea Elliott. And in case you missed it, in honor of Indigenous Peoples Heritage Month, Sand Talk: How Indigenous Thinking Can Save the World by Tyson Yunka Porta. This remarkable book is about everything from echidnas to evolution, cosmology to cooking, sex and science and spirits to Schrodinger's cat. Tyson Yunka Porta looks at global systems from an Indigenous perspective and asks how contemporary life diverges from the pattern of creation. How does this affect us? How can we do things differently? Sand Talk provides a template for living. It's about how lines and symbols and shapes can help us make sense of the world, and how we learn and how we remember. It's about talking to everybody and listening carefully. It's about finding different ways to look at things. Most of all, it's about Indigenous thinking and how it can save the world. Available from HarperOne Publisher and in print from DPL and ebook and e-audiobook format through Overdrive. For further perspective, check out Think Indigenous: Native American Spirituality for a Modern World by Doug Goodfeather, and The Red Deal: Indigenous Action to Save Our Earth by the Red Nation. See the links below in the description for two remaining events at DPL celebrating Indigenous Peoples Heritage Month. November 23rd at 7 p.m. for a discussion of the PBS documentary Colorado Experience Sand Creek Massacre, and a Sand Creek Massacre candlelight vigil taking place November 29th at 6 p.m. And that's it for this month. Thanks for tuning in to Denver Public Library's Friday 5 at 5, and we hope you enjoy the coming holiday with a bunch of great reads and listens. Check out or place a hold on these titles and a whole lot more right now at denverlibrary.org, link below, and be sure to tune in next month for a whole new batch of recommended reads. Bye!